Hachette Audio presents Diversity, Inc., The Failed Promise of a Billion-Dollar Business. Written by Pamela Newkirk. Read by Tracey A. Leigh. Dedication to Marjani and Mikkel. Preface. I have devoted a considerable portion of my life to journalism and higher education, both fields in which people of color are radically underrepresented. In 3 of 4 newsrooms, I was the only African-American news reporter. I would later become one of 2 people of color on New York University's tenure-track journalism faculty, and for a time was one of the few tenured African-American female professors on the entire faculty of the university's Faculty of Arts and Science. During more than 3 decades of my professional life, diversity has been a national preoccupation. Yet despite decades of hand-wringing, costly initiatives, and uncomfortable conversations, progress in most elite American institutions has been negligible. While racial/ethnic minorities make up roughly 38.8% of the national population, they comprise just 17% of full-time university professors, which includes faculty at historically black colleges and universities, HBCUs. Put another way, non-Hispanic whites, who comprise roughly 61% of the population, hold 82% of full-time professorships. Hispanics and blacks, who together encompass roughly 31% of the U.S. population, are just 3% and 4%, respectively, of full-time professors. Their numbers have barely budged over the past few decades. The field of journalism has not fared much better. 4 decades after the newspaper industry pledged to create newsrooms that reflect the proportion of minorities in the population by the year 2000, they too remain disproportionately white. African Americans, Latinos, Asians, and Native Americans combined held 16.55% of newsroom jobs based on the 2017 annual newsroom survey released by the American Society of News Editors. That number was even a slight decrease from the preceding year, and when online news sites were excluded, the percentage of minorities dropped to 16.3%. The numbers in journalism and academia, like those in other influential fields, from the arts, advertising, and fashion to law, technology, and investment banking, defy the quickening pace of change in the nation's racial demographics. In 2011, for the first time in America's nearly 250-year history, more babies of color were born than non-Hispanic whites. Since 2010, non-Hispanic whites have been the minority in 22 of the nation's 100 largest metropolitan areas, and the U.S. Census Bureau projects that by 2045, they will no longer constitute a national majority, which has made diversity one of the buzzwords of the 21st century. But why, after 5 decades of countless studies, public pledges, and high-profile initiatives, is diversity lagging in most elite fields? And why do many white Americans believe that racial progress has been much better than the numbers suggest? Our current diversity conversation began in 1968, when President Lyndon Johnson's National Advisory Commission on Civil Disorders recommended the inclusion of African Americans in institutions that had historically excluded them. The Kerner Commission, as it came to be known, highlighted the need to address the shameful legacy of slavery and Jim Crow. It overlooked, however, the haunting invisibility of Native Americans, an estimated 90% of whom were killed by disease and war in the wake of European settlement. Native Americans and Alaskan Natives, including those of more than one race, number around 6.7 million, or 2% of the population. Regrettably, given their small numbers, they barely register in much of the data. Since 1968, Diversity, of course, has been expanded to encompass other racial and ethnic minorities, along with women, people with physical and mental disabilities, LGBTQIA individuals, and other marginalized populations. However, given the issues unique to each distinct group and the ways in which the plight of racial minorities in general, and African Americans in particular, have been overshadowed by other categories within this overtaxed term, this book will specifically address the progress the nation has made toward racial diversity. Race, of course, is a complicated and often imprecise designation that in the United States has always relied less on ancestry than on appearance. Those who most resemble what is considered white are generally accorded greater status. It's a messy social construction that nonetheless matters when trying to sense the texture of American life for distinct segments of the population. But it is challenging, given the shifting terrain. The classification of Hispanic/Latinx connotes ethnicity and not race, which could range from black to white. And given the invisibility of Native Americans in most metrics, and the ascendance of Asians in STEM fields and in income earning, there is no way to paint a complete portrait of America's complex racial landscape. Further clouding the picture, Asians, who encompass a broad spectrum of people, cultures, and languages across a continent, are, relative to their numbers in the general population, either disproportionately over or underrepresented, depending on the field. To examine the nation's progress toward racial diversity, I focus on the three largest racial/ethnic minority groups: Hispanics/Latinx, African-Americans/Black, and Asian-Americans. I alternately use African-American or Black and Hispanic for the sake of clarity, even though the terminology in the data I cite varies. Encompassed within race and ethnicity are, of course, all the other classifications, including physical and cognitive disability, gender, and sexual orientation, that become doubly or triply burdened by interlocking systems of discrimination. Still, a half century after Kerner, the black-white divide is still most palpable in American life. The stark disparities between the two groups remain the most telling indicators of America's racial breach. However, the expansion of America's racial tableau and the long history of discriminatory federal policies and attitudes directed at other Americans considered non-white require an examination of efforts to fold racial and ethnic minorities into the mainframe of the nation. America, despite the presence and contributions of many, remains, at least in the public imagination and in most realms of influence, dominated by whiteness. I explore diversity across numerous fields, but pay sustained attention to three fields in particular: academia, Hollywood, and corporate America, each of which has publicly and privately grappled with the issue over the past five decades. They are among the fields whose leaders have, in recent years, renewed their commitment to diversity, collectively pledging billions of dollars to commission studies, set up training sessions, and hire consultants and czars to oversee diversity programs. These efforts have, among other things, shored up a multi-billion-dollar industry, expanding opportunities for an ever-growing number of law firms, consultants, and senior-level executives. It's impossible to understand diversity without exploring the big business of it, the tension between the rhetoric and expenditures, and the chronically disappointing results. In recent years, organizations have begun to use the term diversity and inclusion to underscore the need for compositional diversity and institutional belonging. Unless otherwise indicated, the word diversity will imply both. In examining the data and conversing with scores of people on the front line of the movement for change, I discovered some of the reasons why, despite decades of deliberation and multi-billion-dollar initiatives, many are still pondering and gesturing rather than meaningfully increasing diversity. Perhaps most surprising is that many of the fields that are considered the most progressive, such as the arts and entertainment, are the least diverse, and that corporate America, despite remaining challenges, has in many instances made far greater strides toward employing and promoting racial minorities. The plodding pace of change a half century later makes clear the need to reframe the diversity conversation of recent years from a rosy, we are the world ideal to one fired by a mission to combat systemic racial injustice and pervasive delusion about where we stand. Our current predicament is part and parcel of an enduring ideology of white preeminence and the callous resolve that America's global ascent justified the means by which African Americans, Native Americans, and others were ruthlessly exploited. This ethos permeates mass media, so-called high art, the Western literary canon, and our criminal justice and educational systems. The dismal numbers reported year after year are a predictable outcome of this morally impoverished calculus. Unless and until white America, including those who claim progressive values, comes to terms with its complicity in persisting injustice, diversity initiatives will continually fail. Since one's complicity can be willful or stem from benign ignorance and neglect, the latter affords the potential, if not the promise, of serious reflection and reform. The numbers are uninspiring, but the all-too-few examples of change offer a semblance of hope. They can serve as a beacon for those who are truly committed to justice. In the end, we will each be judged not by stated principles, but by our achievements. Given the sturdy foundation of white domination on which America rests, it has perhaps been naive of many diversity advocates to expect even those viewed as progressive allies to relinquish hardwired attitudes and centuries-old customs, no matter how ignobly attained. Many believed that if only they could show the inherent injustice of institutional bias and the ways in which it perpetuates inequality and fuels racial conflict, then attitudes and workplaces would substantially change. 5 decades later, diversity proponents can be forgiven their idealism, if not their fidelity to ineffective approaches. Allies and advocates of diversity, including those who are beneficiaries of the burgeoning industry it has spawned, must also change course lest they become complicit with those who consciously or unconsciously work to sustain the status quo. In their work, they might ask whether they unwittingly serve as smokescreens rather than true agents of change. How might they enable evasion and resistance by the institutions they serve? At what point does it become apparent that institutions they associate with are less committed to diversity than their rhetoric, commissioned task forces, studies, and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.